I have to bring greetings from the mayor. It's supposed to be his meeting tonight, and he was double booked, so he asked me to fill in. And this is interesting because I started community advocacy all the way back in the 80s when I worked with the Seton Community Group, which was People or Planes before that, and fought the Pickering Airport. So what are we, 40 years later, and it'll probably be realized in the next 10 years, but they did a pretty good job of staving it off for 40 years. The other one was when I was with the Federation of Ontario Cottages Association, we fought Dombind. And if you don't know what Dombind Dombind is the liquor that's left after you recycle old corrugated cardboard and you pulp wood. And they used to use it as a road binder in cottage country.
Right.
And it was water soluble, so it flowed off the roads and it flowed into people's dug wells and it flowed into water courses and whatnot. And there was absolutely nothing wrong with it. We've used it for years. No heavy metals in it. What heavy metals are you testing for? Well, they tested for everything except mercury. Guess what?
Yeah, right.
So when we asked to have the mercury test done, there was all kinds of reasons why that couldn't be done. Turns out that there happened to be appreciable levels of mercury. Small. It was a small win, but it was one that we did win in about the late 90s. But there's Sierra Legal Defense Fund was involved in that and a few other rather prominent environmental organizations, but that was when we were known as the tree huggers and environmentalists and whatnot. And I'm the director of economic development, and does anybody know what economic development does? Well, it's supposed to bring in business, but in rural Ontario, most of our business is going to come from entrepreneurs. So we look for a lot of people who are innovative, who are looking for a quality of life, because we're not smokestack chasing anymore. That's passé. So one of the reasons that the city of Porth Lakes, does anybody know where the city of Porth Lakes is?
I do.
Do you? Do you know what it used to be called?
Yeah, either
one. A couple of different things.
It used to be called Victoria County. And there was 16 townships and small communities and whatnot. And one of our councillors now wants us to have a big sign up 415 interchange that says City of Porth Lakes, which is great if you live there. Not so great if you don't live there and you're trying to figure out where Lindsay, Fenland Falls, Bob.
I know. I wish they would.
All these communities that, you know, City of Porth Lakes is 3,000 square kilometers. There's 41 communities in it, and there's 250 lakes and rivers. And that 250 lakes and rivers is part of the Trans-Severn Waterways as well. Balsam Lake Provincial Park. Anybody know where Balsam Lake Provincial Park is?
I do.
About 125,000 visitors a year. It's one of our biggest attractions that we have in that area. It's huge. We also have a very strong seasonal population, about 30, 35,000 people. And what are they looking for? They're looking for waterfront property that offers recreation. We also have 1.5 million people who come into the community every year to take advantage of those recreational opportunities, primarily around water. So what happens when you have blue-green algae in Sturgeon Lake, and Pigeon Lake, and Four Mile Lake? Blue-green algae is really not fun. It's dangerous. Even if you boil it, you still can't drink the water. It's still toxic. So when you're talking about an economy that has for the last 200 years been built on water and continues to rely heavily on water for its two key economic drivers, one of which is agriculture and the other one's tourism. And out of that 303,000 square kilometers, at the south end, we have a very strong agricultural presence. And a lot of that's starting to shift to equine. Well, horses are very susceptible to good water and bad water, as are cattle. And we now have a lot of sheep and goats, and that services the multicultural market in Toronto. So without really high quality water in our area, both of our key economic drivers are going to take it right in the teeth. So when I came to work in Porth Lakes, I was bringing experience from Muskoka, and everybody knows Muskoka. You just have to say Muskoka, and everybody just associates that with cottaging and water. Peterborough, on the other hand, yeah, it was time well served in Peterborough. When I started, there was no economic development in the 8 townships that make up Peterborough County. So when I came in, all the politicians would kind of look at me and go, what the hell do you think you're going to do for us? So we had to explain what it was we were doing. And guess what? They're very reliant on water in 5 of the 8 townships for seasonal residents. Muskoka, seasonal residents. And you've got a lot of people that are starting to retire into these 3 communities. And if you add Halliburton, I was planning administrator in Minden Hills for a very short period of time because I had a CAO that kept changing planning reports on me. Yeah, you know what? You don't have the same level of understanding about planning that I do, even if you are the CAO, so we're done. And that was it. In Halliburton County, I tried to get council to pass a resolution for planning applications that asked for a 10-meter nutrient entrapment zone. And that was because natural vegetation goes down 6 inches. Who referenced the 6 inches? It goes down 6 inches. Grass goes down 1.5 to 2 inches. And of course, you have to be able to see the water. If you're a seasonal resident, how many cottagers? Any cottagers today? A couple. Do you have to see the water, Ian?
We try to prepare, have a buffer, but you do want to see the water.
So most cottagers, when they want to see the water, well, you got to get rid of those damn big things called trees. So you cut them down. Well, if you cut down the trees, the only vegetation that's going to survive in that now is grass. Well, grass doesn't hold nutrient well, and it doesn't hold the soil well, especially if you've got a podzolic soil. It's very acidic, it's very sandy. Hard to grow stuff in it. That's why you have things like yellow plantonia and blueberry bushes and whatnot that grow in that soil. But if you cut it all down, it all flows into the water. Of course, you've got to fertilize it because you want a nice green lawn, right? So you can come up on the weekends and cut it.
I hate
that. And then on Sunday night, cut the grass in the city. I can never understand that. It doesn't make sense to me. In any rate, council said, no, we can't do that because cottagers want to see the water. So you have to cut the trees down. Okay, so what if we said they had to have an arborist come in and trim the trees up? Well, it's not the same thing. You're right, it's not. You have to leave the trees. Just one. Because the drip line on a tree is about 30 feet. So just one tree from the shore back. No, that's too many.
Okay.
So, you have local councils trying to appease their target market, which happens to be the cottagers. Now, Ontario for years has said no strip development. Well, what do you have around a lake if it's not strip development? It's strip development. Sorry, that's what it is. Because it's just a strip right around. And of course, if you're the cottager, once you've bought your waterfront lot, you don't want the lot behind it developed. Hell no. You've got your piece of paradise, close the gate, lock it. So for years, our water has taken a beating. Why? Because we want to enjoy it. Okay, think about that for a second. You want to enjoy the water, but you're going to abuse the hell out of it in the meantime. If you've ever watched a cottager fill up his boat, his outboard, takes a 5-gallon jug down the water, it's into the boat, pours gas in. Oh yeah, some slop in the water, that's okay, don't worry about that. It'll dissipate. The solution to pollution is?
Dilution.
There you go. So we've done this for years, and if you ask a cottager, what's the littoral zone around the lake? They'll look at you like you're talking
great.
A three-letter word, right? Well, it's a very critical zone that is the transfer from the shoreline to the water. And we've kicked the living out of that for years, right? So when you've got a college like Fleming College, who focuses in on natural resources, and they're world renowned for this, You have a professor like Dr. Wooten who comes in and says, I want to start the Center for Alternative Wastewater Treatment. All of these things kind of mesh together. If you now have a landscape that people desperately want to come to as they retire, because you want to get out of the city, and trust me, I understand that. And you want to come up to a place where you can see the birds. So for example, Kawartha Lakes has the Cardinalvar. Anybody know what the Cardinalvar is? Cardinalvar is a beautiful limestone feature. So what do you get with limestone? You get a lot of aggregate, you get a lot of quarries. So we happen to be the third largest aggregate producer in the province. And this Cardinalvar is an international birding area. It's an IBA. Very few people know that. We've been working with Kuchichin Conservancy to change that, but the Kuchichin Conservancy has taken this area under their protective wing, and we have a lot of quarries that are making application constantly in that area. Of course, they're butting up against the cottagers, because when you start taking limestone out, water has to go somewhere. It doesn't stay in the lake. It leaves. So we have these constant balancing acts that we have to do. Now the mayor is very high on aggregate, but he wants the aggregate to be managed properly. So we're about the only municipality in the province right now that's putting a secondary plan together around aggregate. And we're doing that in conjunction with Fleming College, because Fleming College is all about natural resources, whether it's trees, whether it's water, fish. They have a great aquaculture program, by the way, that's just starting to come back. And if you talk about local food, well, just as a bit of a response to the local food one, they're talking about cucumbers in two semis.
Yeah.
Well, how much, what was the carbon footprint required to make that two truckloads of cucumbers?
Right.
They weren't talking about the carbon footprint there. They were talking about carbon footprint to bring it from there to here, and versus up all the local transportation. They were just talking about transportation. They weren't talking about production.
No, they don't.
Very isolated on this.
Yes.
And that was a very interesting argument that they were proposing that's going to be coming down the pipeline.
See, we have a local food charter in Kawartha Lakes. So we had a group of volunteers that came together, and then they put together a local food charter. When I was in Peterborough, Kawartha Lakes had already started Kawartha Farm Fresh, or Kawartha Choice. So we started one in Peterborough called Kawartha Farm Fresh. Now it's Kawartha Choice Farm Fresh, and we work together. It's not easy. It took 18 months to get a letter of intent signed that just said we're going to collaborate on projects around water. And that was a presentation to Haliburton County, which, by the way, has the headwaters for the Trans-Severn Waterway, and is home to all of the reservoir lakes for the Trans-Severn Waterway. And the history behind that's slightly more than 100 years. So that was a bit of a... Peterborough, the city of Peterborough, they were the last, and we really had to battle to get them to sign on. Peterborough County, well, what's going to cost? What's in it for us? Well, I don't know. Trent University, which has the Institute for Watershed Science, has more mass spectrometers than any other university in the province. When you start to look at all these assets that we have in the area, the question becomes, why didn't we start doing this 20 years ago? Because we have these tremendous assets. Haliburton County has over 600 lakes and rivers. We have 250. I can't remember how many Peterborough has, about 200.
You have Kawartha Dairy Farms too. They make great ice cream.
Well, we have Kawartha Dairy, which you're right, it's a premium ice cream, it's great, but we now also have Mariposa Dairy, and if you go into your local Loblaws or independent, and you look for celebrity cheese, goat cheese, mm-hmm. It comes wrapped in cranberries and pesto and things like that. Well, that's made in Lindsay.
Yay.
One of the biggest goat farms in the province right now, and if you drive along Highway 7 between Oakwood and Lindsay, on the north side of 7, you'll see this great big coverall. It's huge. It's about 4 in a row. That's one of the biggest goat herds in the province right now. They're running about 1,600 milking goats. They've got about another 1,800 kids that most of those go for meat. They currently farm, I think, around 1,800 acres. And this is local farming, right? Like local farming now, if you talk to somebody about a 100-acre farm, well, that's a bit of a joke. That's a hobby farm. And that's for somebody like me who's making money working somewhere else, because 100 acres isn't going to, you're not going to survive on that anymore. You start talking about some of the other organizations that we have in the area that feed into this kind, just into water alone. So the Stewardship Council, the Victoria County Land and Stewardship Council, does a lot with water. And I know that because I sat on it for 4 years and I was the chair for a year. We do a lot with water. You have the Environmental Farm Plan, which does a lot with water, because we're trying to figure out how to keep the nutrients out. You've got the Nutrient Management Plan, and all of these things all affect water. And these are things that we live with every day in our community. So to partner up, and like I was making notes as different people were talking, because I sit on the steering committee for Sea Links. Sea Links is a group of people from the community that came together because we're looking for projects in the community that students can get credit for working on those projects. It's like the course for credit, but it's a little bit different too. We have 18 libraries in Kawartha Lakes. So they were looking for places where information could be gathered about projects and information could be disseminated. Well, what better spot than a library? Because people will come into a library to look for information, to find directions, to find out about the community. So here's an opportunity for us to really tap into Fleming College. And we've done this in a big, big way. So we have an MOU with Fleming College now. Now that we have the letter of intent signed, with Halliburton, Peterborough, County, City, Trent, Fleming. Now we're talking about we expect to sign it this week, an MOU with Aqua. Everybody knows what Aqua is?
Ontario
Clean Water Agency. And they look after, we have 21 water treatment plants in Kawartha Lakes, and they look after about 16 of them. So why would we want to be involved with groups that want to find different ways to look at water? Well, our budget debate this year was really interesting. Council wants to conserve water. Makes sense. So you put in low flush toilets and low flow shower heads, and, you know, sell rain barrels at the city hall and things like that. That's great. And then our water treatment operator came in and she said, okay, so we're going to do all these conservation measures and we're only going to send out 75% of the water. I'm just grabbing a number out of the air. 75% of the water. Provinces said our water cleanliness of our water has to come up to here. Has to improve by 5 to 6%. So that's going to cost us about $8 million to do. You've just reduced our revenues by $1 million. Oh, so what you're telling us then is that this improvement is going to cost $9 million. Yep. Well, that's not good. So the conundrum is, do we put more users on that system and at what cost? Or do we just suck it up? No pun intended. Financially. Or we go back to the province and say, okay, so you've told us that we have to improve to this point, and we've got a whole bunch of systems over here where we've only got 50, maybe 100, maybe 150 users on them. You know, it's cheaper for us to drill a well for that 150 users and close that system entirely. Is the province going to let us do that? Not a chance. So, you know, you've got the two curves going in opposite directions. So we have to find ways to be more efficient and more effective with how we clean water.